Hey everybody, welcome back. Great to see you again. In our last slide discussion, we said that there were two major problems at the end of the 18 into the 1900s that led to the replacement of Maxwell's theory of electromagnetic light as the final word on the question of what is light and how does it work. And one of those things was the black body problem. So the idea was that if you took a fireplace poker and put it in a fire, it's common sense, it always glows red at lower temperatures. And if you wanted to get it to go yellow, it's got to be hotter. And yet, Maxwell's theory didn't match this reality. The second thing that was known going back to the early 1800s was that if you studied color, you would sometimes see what are called line spectrum. Now, later on in the 1800s, as people developed the technology to make a vacuum tube, suck all the air out of it, and then pump it full of a gas, and finally, zap it with high voltage, they saw something completely unexpected and unexplainable by the physics of the time. And here's what it was. That if you took hydrogen and put it inside of a tube, you get one color of light, deuterium, a different color of light, nitrogen, oxygen, mercury, they all give off their own spectrum. And what's really wild is like this example right here for hydrogen, the spectrum doesn't look anything like a black body, and it doesn't look anything like what you and I think of when we think of a spectrum. This is called a line spectrum. So this is a giant mystery. Why would atoms of a gas not give off all the colors, but only specific colors? And so the solution to this problem ended up dramatically changing what we thought we knew about the smallest level of the world, so the atom itself. And that's the story for today. Let's check it out. So as we get rolling into our explanation of the atom, it's really important to take stock right now of what was really known in 1911 and not just some fairy tale that y'all might have heard about in school. So here's what was known. Rutherford's gold foil experiment demonstrated that most of the atom was empty, that the mass of the atom was concentrated in the interior of the atom with all the positive charge located there in an incredibly small space called the nucleus. That insane part is absolutely true. The rest of the story is where the fairy tale part comes in. The electron would have orbited that positive core because it's attracted to the nucleus, just like the moon would be attracted to the Earth by the force of gravity, electrostatics, gravity, so similar, it's gotta work, right? Garbage. Rutherford knew that was hogwash and that this model of the atom was dead on arrival in 1911. And here's why. We know from classical Maxwell theory of light that when you accelerate charged particles, maybe you whip them up and down in an antenna, that's when they give off radiation. So use your common sense and think about this graphic over here on the right. If an electron is orbiting in any kind of way around a nucleus, it's accelerating. It's got centripetal acceleration. And that electron would radiate, which means it would lose energy. And that electron would always invariably spiral into the nucleus. Rutherford even calculated how long it would take for this electron to kill itself in the nucleus. And it's something like 10 to the minus 15 seconds. So there should be no stable atoms anywhere in the world. So what was wrong and what needed to happen? Sometimes physics isn't clean. Sometimes physics is messy and you need some provisional ideas that are like stepping stones to get to the real answer. And let's go check out the most important stepping stone you're probably gonna ever learn about in physics. It's called the Bohr model of the atom. Let's go get it. So in 1913, Niels Bohr published his model of the hydrogen atom. And what it did was it combined Einstein's idea that energy jumps weren't just a fiction that was needed to make Max Planck's graphs come out right. It was really something innate to nature, that waves of light came in chunky particles called photons. And what Bohr did was to postulate, so that means he just threw it out there, like, let's say this is true and go from there and see what happens. He put out a postulate that said, never mind the whole electrons radiating things because they're going in circles, let them have stationary orbits, whatever that means. It means, is an electron stationary or is it just moving around and it can't radiate? It doesn't matter. We're just gonna assume that the electron is fixed in this orbit or this orbit or this orbit, and that's the only place it can be. So what's the difference between those energy states? It comes in chunks of energy that are exactly what Einstein used in calculating the energy of photons. So the difference between two energy levels is the energy of a photon that would be given off or absorbed when the electron changes between energy states. The second condition that Bohr imposed was that the angular momentum of the electrons would have to be quantized. That means it could only come in certain sized chunks. So if you've studied angular momentum, great. If you haven't, that's okay. Angular momentum is like regular momentum, mv, except we multiply by the radius of the mass from the center of moment. So these two statements taken together gave him a starting point where he could derive some conditions, and here's what he came up with. The energy of these allowed stationary states is given by this formula right here, negative 13.6 electron volts divided by n squared. So n is, again, the number of the state. And the radius, how far that electron is away from the center of the atom, is given by this formula right here. So the one that we spend most of our time is this first one. And what we're basically going to do in this slide is a calculation you're going to do versions of in class. What wavelength of light will be produced by an electron that drops from n equals 1 or n equals 2 down to into n equals 1? To answer that, you first of all have to know what the energy of each of those states is. So we're going to do this first part first, and it's not hard to do. To get n equals 1 and get the energy of that state, this is simplicity itself, negative 13.6 over 1 squared gives you negative 13.6 EVs. So if you're thinking about this from a photoelectric effect standpoint, and I hope you are, you should say, wow, that electron is really stuck. Yeah, that's a huge work function. So it's really hard to rip away one electron from one proton when they're separated by this tiny, tiny distance, which is going to be 0.529 times 10 to the minus 10 meters, right? So to get E2, do the same thing, negative 13.6 EVs over 2 squared, and we get negative 3.4 EVs. So to answer this question, ultimately, what's the wavelength of light? We're just going to use the first formula that you should have written down from the last slide, which is, what's the change in energy? It's going to be, in this case, E final minus E initial, right? So it's going to be E1 minus E2, and that's going to equal Planck's constant times the frequency. Or if we really want to be fancy and cut the line, we're going to write down our other version that we used with the photoelectric effect. HF is the same as HC over lambda. Okay, so what I'm going to do is just put those constants of nature together and go do that off camera, and then we'll check it out and see what you get. So notice what I did. I used the appropriate unit version of Planck's constant for the energy units that I'm given. And you should end up with this if you're following along, 1.22 times 10 to the negative 7 meters. So I like to write it in nanometers, not just because it fits on my slide, but because it lets me use this graphic that you've looked at before for comparison. So visible light is everything from 700 nanometers or so down in the red to around 400 nanometers or so in the violet. So this particular wave is a really strong ultraviolet, which should make sense. We know that ultraviolet is an ionizing kind of radiation and that it can really do exactly what we're talking about. It can boost an electron from an atom that wants to hold on to it because it just has that much energy. Okay, so what we're going to do is just turn our attention to some of the pluses and some of the minuses of the Bohr model. So let's go check that out and we'll wrap it up. So the first thing to recognize about the Bohr model of the atom is that it's never selling itself as something that it's not. A model in science is an idea that gets the key thing right. A theory is a much bigger, more comprehensive thing that's expected to do a lot more. But the Bohr model of the atom was just trying to capture how do we get line spectra and explain how atoms can exist. And it did that. What it didn't do was it didn't predict the spectra for any atoms that weren't hydrogen. So the second little bullet on this slide was that it only worked for helium with one electron or doubly ionized lithium. It only worked for one electron atom, which is weird, but it did work perfectly for hydrogen, which is really intriguing. And the second thing was a philosophical problem. Physicists really like ideas to be organic, to be grounded in the deepest science that they know, and Niels Bohr's postulates of quantized angular momentum in non-radiating orbits were really unsatisfying to them because they were ad hoc, which means they were just inserted because they were needed. We had to start somewhere. So how can we still teach this thing at all? Well, It gets the key things right, as we said. This model of the atom brought together Einstein's idea of quanta and Rutherford's nuclear atom in a package that gave other physicists who came later the really key insight. And that key insight was that electron energies somehow had to be quantized. No matter what the electron was or how you thought about it, it had to have an energy jump that was consistent with this picture right here. So we're going to get that second piece of the puzzle down the road. In any case, we'll talk about this more in class. Have a great day and take care. Bye-bye.